The inspiration, the muse, if you will, for this build was eBay. Wait, what? Yeah, so go on eBay now and just search gaming PC. Chances are the first 10 results will consist of a load of second generation i5 and i7 builds that have been shoved into a cheapo glitzy CIT case and called a gaming PC. And if you are lucky, they might even come with a super mega incredible gaming GPU that is colloquially known as the GT710. You know the ones they advertise as being ultra fast, amazing machines for Fortnite and PUBG. And if you dare select anything other than a glorious default GPU, say a GT 1650 or something of that nature, the price instantly shoots up to the stratosphere. The idea was to take the default price point that doesn't even include an SSD and try to, well, make a gaming PC fit to it, and really it wasn't easy. I've done a previous build along the same lines a while ago, funny enough in the exact same case, because I ended up selling the components as the buyer had his own case. So, without other way, let's get started. This time it's an AMD build centered around the Ryzen 1300X, a 4-core and 4-thread CPU that is housed in an A320 motherboard from MSI and paired with the obligatory 16GB of DDR4 RAM, and runs at 2400 Mbps. Bit low for Ryzen, I know, but for budget builds the quantity is far more important than the speed. Cooling the CPU is a cooler brand I've never seen before, but with two heat pipes and two 80mm fans, it keeps the CPU in check very well, with the temperature peaking around 68°C, and that is with the fans running up to 5V. Long story, apparently the motherboard I'm using will only do PWM control, which is a bit annoying in a budget board. Also, my heartfelt congratulations to the chap that designed the clamping mechanism, as he made the robust clamp somehow feel cheap. I really can't explain it better than that. It provides decent mounting pressure and it is robust, but at the same time it gives you a very funny uneasy feeling. It's gonna snap or explode at any moment. And now, for the first time ever, say hello to a new angle. And the pig flies on the wall. Next thing to go in is a 700 watt PSU from Kolling that will provide plenty of power for this build. It does have a bit of coil whines, and please, as much as the purists would like you to believe it, coil whine is not a product defect. This particular case, considering the GPU that will go in there is a blower style one, it's basically a moot point if it has any coil whine or not. As usual, a little bit of electrical tape on the Ketchup Monster cables goes a really long way to tidying out the build, especially since it has a GPU viewport. Next, the GPU goes in, and this time I again reach for a GTX 970. I am a bit bummed it's a blower style card, but at this price point spending an extra 10 to 20 pounds on a dual fan model is very difficult to justify. I know this will provide adequate performance, especially for the price, and for the first time, and probably last, on this channel I feel the need to quote a user benchmark score, as it lists the GTX 970 as 1398% faster than the GT710. Please, just in case I haven't mentioned it enough, this PC is targeting the exact same price point. I opted to include a 500GB hard drive. I give this out as freebies in all my builds, as most get shipped, and well, drops during shipping and hard drives don't mix that well. Hey, free is free at the end of the day, and until now all but one have indeed survived unscathed. Another bit that I am fuffing about with now is a 256GB SATA SSD. It needs to go into its own adapter caddy and then into the slidable caddy from the case. I honestly really just like screws, because trying to plug a plastic adapter into another plastic piece can be a bit annoying, but in the end I got there and it's secured inside. And now all it's left to do is pull it all together. I won't kill myself with cable management and button compartment, because, well, nobody will see it since the window is only at the top portion. And I did end up changing a couple of the fans, long story short, just to have something PWM in the motherboard, just to make sure I avoid any CPU fail errors at boot up. Finally, let's turn it on and see how it's looking. Hey, not bad. I think it's a lot more impressive in low light, and for a PC on the inexpensive end of the spectrum, that looks very good indeed. Here's a look at the final product, and I shall see you in the benchmarking section. First up, it's heaven, and this being a GPU benchmark, it performs exactly as one would expect. It stresses the GPU to its upper limit and spits out the result we were all hoping for. I'm not going to dwell too much on the GPU only test this time around, because I've benchmarked GTX 970s plenty of times before, and even a couple of times on this channel. Anyways, my expectation was about 86 FPS and got 88.1. Something that either highlights that I know what I'm doing, or I'm rather sad for knowing that. Oof. Superposition is a much newer benchmark from the same team behind Heaven, and this time around at medium settings 1080p we got 56 FPS on average, again a very much expected result. From now on it gets a lot more interesting. And the first proper game that we'll be looking at today is Rocket League, and with everything turned up as far as it will go, we got a very respectable 176 FPS on average. We do encounter a bit of frame swings, but nothing jarring that will affect the game, as we are way above most monitors' refresh rates, so unless you look at the frame counter, most people will be, well, oblivious to them. Fortnite, with everything set to epic, we got 42 FPS on average out of the system. Surprisingly enough, the bottleneck is not the GPU but the CPU. This is a situation where overclocking the Ryzen chip would give us better performance, but with the A-series chipsets, this isn't allowed. Dropping the settings down to medium with epic draw distance alleviates much of the issues, with the new average being 74 and a lot smoother frame pacing. The bottleneck is still the CPU, but the experience is so much better. Obviously, you can go even lower or, dare I say, performance mode, but I feel this strikes a good balance between visual and fluidity, unless you are a parkour Fortnite gamer, if that's a thing. Horizon Zero Dawn is the first AAA title of today's benchmark roster, and at 60 FPS on average, it delivers a very nice gaming experience at favor quality settings. Keep in mind that the in-game benchmark is much harsher in nature than the actual game, so expect even better averages and frame time pacing while playing. Dare I say it, you can even go ultimate quality with some tweaks if you choose to. Not bad for a budget rig. Stranding is based on the same engine as Horizon Zero Dawn, but better optimized, so here I went straight for gold with all the settings turned up to maximum. And would you look at that, the limiting factor is again the CPU, but we are sticking so close to 60 FPS with decent frame time pacing that it really does not matter. I did do a little experiment and push the memory to 2800 at 1.32 volts and CL17, and that greatly helped the CPU, pushing the power draw towards 55 watts and the frame time was glued to 60. Biomutant is still a bit of a wildcard for me, as I haven't gotten around to really playing it, but at least it has the decency of being GPU limited. At max settings it is surprisingly very playable with about 39 FPS on average, but if it was me I would drop it down to medium so we are closer to 60. This is a kind of Twitch shooter after all, so a lot of people would argue that more frames equals more better. Cyberpunk 2077 just squeezes by as being playable at low. I know for a fact that this GPU can do about 40 FPS at tweak medium settings, but unfortunately this game really hates quad cores without SMT. If you don't mind the occasional dip into the high 20s, you will be able to play and enjoy this. Personally, I will not touch the resolution scale or fidelity effects because I feel it's akin to smearing Vaseline on the monitor and ruining the experience, even if it does boost the FPS a little bit. Again, tweaking the memory helps, but don't expect a 60 FPS miracle. From what I've seen, this is the same sort of graphical fidelity and frame rate you also get them from a base PS4, so hey, if the consoles can get away with it, why not here? I even think it runs at a lower resolution on console or something of that nature. Assassin's Creed Valhalla is a good looking game, but based on a rickety old engine that has had stuff bolted onto it over the years, making it very inefficient, and that made the 38 FPS on average even more surprising. This is primarily a sightseeing game, so at medium you still get quite a lot of eye candy with decent performance at full HD. I don't think I would mind playing this game on this machine. And finally, Days Gone, another superbly optimized game. I knew before I tested it that the CPU would be the limiting factor here. I discovered that factor out a while back, but the average FPS still made for a pleasant surprise, hovering around 55 FPS with more pronounced dips when driving through the ghost towns around the game at full bore on your motorcycle. Overall, I would not hesitate to play this game like this. Turning up the settings higher doesn't do much apart from tanking the FPS, and since we are CPU limited anyway, going down in resolution or detail doesn't help that much, which leads me to conclude that these are the sweet spot settings. Not bad considering we're looking at high at full HD. And that's it for another video. I hope you enjoy it and see you in the next one.